Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sidewinders by Robert V.S. Redick. Narrated by Eric Michael Summerer. And though they hide themselves in the top of Carmel, I will search and take them out thence. And though they be hid from my sight in the bottom of the sea, thence I will command the serpent, and he shall bite them. Amos chapter 9, verse 3. You'd better not invite me to be my natural self. Don't risk it. Dostoevsky, The Brothers Karamazov. Prologue. Kandri's People. The weight of his deed, and what must follow from it, are clear to him before the blood soaks through his trousers and begins to cool against his legs. But what is plain to the intellect is often shunned by the heart and denied outright by the imagination. So it happens that he is far from the dead man, from the crooked shack and slumbering army, before he truly grasps what he has done. His people understand the gods. Knowledge wearies them, even of the smallest of lives. Mortal pain is sharp and certain, mortal error constant as the dawn. No one could endure a perpetual view of our stumbles, our bruised shins and broken crockery, our cities put to the torch. A rich man walls off his garden, hiding views of squalor. The gods placed a mountain between heaven and earth. We may never see it, but it towers above us, transparent against the firmament. Icy peak higher than the moon. Sometimes the gods visit the mountain, the better to spy on their imperfect children. Otherwise it stands deserted, a quiet and a sacred place. On many nights after the killing, he finds himself on this mountain, seeing as the gods alone are meant to see. Blackness, stars, and the great world spread below, cold and beautiful and weathered like buckskin. Desiccated, torn. Canyons, rifts, fossil forests, seas of sand. And directly beneath him, two men fleeing for their lives. They have emerged from an enormous war camp, a sleeping city almost. They are young men and run swiftly, due east, straight for the world's desert heart. One, tall and lean, but erratic in his movements, the other stronger, steadier, laboring to keep up. Fear deforms their expressions. Knives and machetes dangle from their belts. They do not speak. They rarely look at each other. They are brothers, but severed. Even in their manner of running, one can see the broken trust. For a time, nothing else in the wide world moves. Then a small commotion, a pinprick, disturbs the camp. Someone has poked the ant nest. Soldiers trickle from the wound. A handful light upon the brothers' trail and set off in pursuit. They are horsemen, much faster than the brothers, but the watcher on the mountain keeps his eyes on the camp. The pinprick has grown into a sore. Lamps are lit. Men spill from their hammocks. A second, larger party sets off behind the first. The brothers are well ahead, but the gap is shrinking. The third posse is 200 strong. Always at this point, he thinks he will turn away, drift to the far side of the mountain, gaze on some other, greener world. But that is forbidden. He must see it all, the savage earth, the fury of his comrades, the burning temples, laughter and necromancy. Love flung at the desert like fistfuls of seed. Matters pass beyond reason. The whole camp shudders awake. 3,000 set off after the brothers, wailing for vengeance, blades held high. He sends the fugitives a prayer. You're not fiends. Don't believe them. Run, run until you've left this hate behind. Lightning crackles. The skies convulse. The camp itself tears free of the earth and roars eastward, overtaking, devouring its soldiers. Then the whole plain, then the country, rabid and unforgiving. The brothers are estranged but have only each other to rely on, to point fingers at, to redeem or denounce. They must outrun their country, that million-eyed monster, the people whose gods they have slain. 1. The Caravan. When the river ascends the mountain, and the earthquake mends the arch, and the desert toad swallows the rattlesnake, and the children of evil are redeemed by love, then shall we lay down this burden of memory and live as others do. Walking Song of the Mistajav Clan, from Parthen Testimony and Demeanor by Theral Agathar. 1. The Wasp. Vasaru Gorge, Outer Basin, Great Desert of Uroth, 79th day of winter, 3661. The pit had appalled him even before he learned what it contained. From the plateau above, it was merely a round hole in the earth, but as they descended, it took on a quality of menace. Broad, black, dry as a desert tomb. Here on the canyon floor, it gaped at him, promising nothing but disaster, a chill wind moaning across its mouth. He had no wish to approach it. Who in their right mind would? "Come," urged the camel drivers, breath blooming white through chattering teeth. "Visit with us a special place, the Well of Rifolundra, once only, mandatory." "What's down there?" he asked. Smiling at his unease, but nervous themselves, they took his arms and led him straight for the pit. 14 men, nudging, hustling. "You have to look, Mr. Kandri," they murmured. "Don't you want good luck in the desert? Who knows if you will pass this way again? What if you die?" "That's just what I was thinking," he said. Dawn had come. Jackals sobbed in the hills. The camels stood immense and obdurate, and the sun etched their sawtooth shadows on the canyon floor. The mercenaries lurched among the animals, blinking and grimacing. The caravan master was trimming his beard. Kandri's toes were numb and his hands cramped with cold. "Why me?" he wanted to shout at the camel men. "I'm a coward, see? I don't even like basements." "Why us?" their fixed smiles replied. "We have just entered the desert, this great killer who dispatches even the best of us, the most sage and seasoned, indifferent as the rag that wipes the soot from the kettle. Now you appear, and we must accept you. Share our camels and our water and our way. They are rationed. Life is rationed. Why should we die that you might live?" "Aren't we leaving?" he tried, more anxious with each step. "The saddlebags, my gear. I'm not ready for the march."
"First things first, Mr. Kandri. Spurn a blessing, and you may not arrive at all."
The caravan had descended the ridge in darkness. 90 drivers, 40 fighting men and women, a threadbare prince and his lone retainer, a surgeon, a cook, a dour desert veteran bringing up the rear. 150 camels, a dozen goats to be eaten in stages, a crate of pigeons and a pocket owl, whatever that was, 2 hairless dogs. They were in mortal need of haste, but only a few of them knew why. The caravan master had forbidden Kandri and his companions to reveal the truth of their situation. When Kandri's half-brother Mektu observed that the truth would encourage speed in just about anyone, the master had given him a stern rebuke.
"I set the pace, and the rest comply. They need no further motivation. And you know nothing of the desert or its people to suggest such a thing."
All the same, they had set out before midnight. This daybreak pause was their first. As they marched him to the pit, Kandri glanced at the bleary-eyed company. One soldier sharpening her dagger, another limbering up against the cold, 2 men burying the camel dung lest it give them away, 4 figures hunched over a dying cook fire, and 1 pair of small, nimble hands toasting flatbread on the blade of someone's machete.
The owner of those hands looked up suddenly and met his gaze. Eshet, desert woman, quietest and most mysterious of his circle of travelers. She was to leave them at sunset tomorrow, when the caravan passed the turnoff to her people's village. Kandri rolled his eyes. Harmless game. They want to show me so badly. Eshet's face was inscrutable. Her eyes moved to the pit and back again, and she shook her head almost invisibly. They were newly lovers. In the night, they had crept away from the caravan, made love standing up in a cleft between boulders, the wind howling about them like a beast in pain, laughing at themselves, at the cold and discomfort, the shooting stars that kept bursting overhead as if in mock congratulations, knowing that her departure was certain, that to indulge in talk of some other ending would be to wound themselves with fantasy, that 2 days and one night remained to them and must not be lost to grief. Besides, there were entanglements. Mektu himself loved Eshet, however boorish his attempts to show it. And the brothers were already divided, had nearly become enemies for a time over a woman from their own clan.
"Never tell him about us," Eshet had said the night before as they held each other in the wind. "Promise me that before I go. You'll win back the heart of that other, if she's truly out there. And that will hurt Mektu enough."
"What if I come looking for you instead? What if I take you home?" She had laughed. The idea was preposterous. Neither Kandri nor his brother nor their uncle Chindelin could ever go home. They could only run, evading as many of the prophet's servants as they could and killing the rest. The desert in its soul-swallowing vastness might yet save them, if they could lose their pursuers here and emerge alive on its far shores. In that abstract country beyond the sands, a city awaited them. Kasralys, ancient and eternal. They could dream of safety within its walls, and even, in time, some new path in life. But home? Never. Home was lost to them. All that remained of it was each other. Kasralys. The city haunted him in dreams. Safety was the first reason they had to find it. But Kandri had a second, hidden reason, and he felt it more keenly than survival itself.
"Her name is Arikina," he said to Eshet, not knowing why.
"She's waiting there, is she?"
Waiting. He could have laughed. When had Ari ever waited for anyone? But she's there, in Kasralys. She has to be.
"Tell me something about her," said Eshet.
Kandri held up his hand, showed her the worthless copper ring from the neck of a fever syrup bottle he wore on his thumb. "She gave me this."
"And made a joke about it being a love charm," said Eshet. "That's sweet and boring, and you've talked about it before. Something else."
Kandri thought for a moment, then smiled. "She told me once that if you saw an odd number of shooting stars, it meant good luck for love or friendship. But an even number was terrible luck, because it could always be split in two." And that wasn't like her, believing such nonsense. She's a doctor. She knows how things work.
"And Mektu loves this woman?"
"Mektu loves you, Eshet." They both knew he had dodged her question.
"What about her own feelings?" asked Eshet.
Silence, alas, was not among his options. "She cared for us both," he admitted. "But she cared for Mech the way you do for a brother, a very little brother. But with the two of us..."
"That's why he resents you," said Eshet, laughing. "Because you always get the girl."
"What do you mean, always?" Kandri demanded. "Before you, there was Ari. Before Ari, there was no one." Eshet reached up and gripped his chin.
"Never a word about us," she said again. "Promise me, right now."
Kandri drew a deep breath. He promised, but he added that his brother already suspected the truth. Mektu was jealous if they walked within 6 feet of each other, shared a biscuit, exchanged a glance.
"How lucky for everyone," said Eshet, "that I'll soon disappear."
The mouth of the pit was fringed with button cacti and dead grass. Radiant cracks gave it the likeness of a window pierced by a stone. He could have bolted when he saw Eshet's reaction, that small but unmistakable no. He could have fought out of their grip and fled back to the main company, safe for the moment, and branded spineless, craven, incapable of trust.
"Closer," they urged him. "This is a holy place. Do not refuse us, please."
Kandri chuckled, a fly wallowing in tar. He had such fine, such excellent reasons to refuse. It was late. Soon the shadows would vanish and the heat would search them out. And the death squads on the road behind them, they would be searching too.
"Don't fear, Mr. Kandri," said an older man with one cataract-clouded eye. "No danger unless you disturb it. Otherwise, it sleeps."
Kandri blinked at him. The language they shared was neither the driver's mother tongue nor his own.
"What sleeps?" he demanded. "Are you telling me something lives in there? I thought you called this thing a well."
"Yes, yes," they all assured him. "A mighty well, an imperial well, the very life of the district in earlier times. With stairs, landings, carvings of the gods, alcoves for the storage of tubers and grain. Broad here at the surface, but narrowing to a bottleneck in the depths above the water source."
"There's still water in that hole?"
"Oh no, yes, maybe," gabbled the drivers, before arguing their way to a consensus. The world was drier now. The desert had advanced. Maybe water still flowed in the depths, but only a fool would seek it. The well had passed out of human hands. It belonged to the wasp.
"Wasps, did you say?"
"The wasp," repeated the camel drivers. They considered him warily, as though alarmed by the extent of his ignorance. Then Kandri saw his brother standing at the back of the crowd. Mektu's long-fingered hands squirmed at his sides. His lips were puckered in bewilderment.
"The wasp," he said. "That makes no goddamned sense. How big is the wasp?"
Some of the men threw their arms wide. Others tisked and pinched the air. The wasp was tiny, unless it was huge.
"I have a great idea," said Mektu. "Let's leave."
Kandri nodded. The break was over. The master's aide was waving his red kerchief. But the camel drivers stood their ground. Eyes closed, fists pressed together beneath their chins, the oldest among them chanting in a whisper.
"Thanks for this, everyone," said Mektu, overloud. "I mean it. We're honored to have seen this dead, cold, creepy—"
"Mektu," said Kandri. "They're praying." Startled, Mektu uttered an obscenity, and the drivers flinched. Kandri glared at him, and Mektu hid his face in the crook of his elbow, as he did when overcome with shame. The drivers chanted,
"Seedlings, our people, flowering in dust, life where there was no life, brief mornings of green."
And everyone crouched down to rub a little of the dry earth against their foreheads. Everyone save Mektu, who could not see what was happening. Kandri considered a prayer of his own for good behavior from Mektu. His brother had yet to insult the drivers in any ghastly way, but it would come. They had caught up with the caravan just 3 days before.
"But what of your own behavior, Kandri? How close did you come to that worst of insults, spitting on an outstretched hand?"
For it was suddenly clear to him that the camel drivers meant no harm at all. In their odd, alien way, they had tried to befriend him, include him in a sacred moment. Him, and not his lout of a brother. And yet, he had imagined the worst. A sacrifice. Madness. Mutiny. The stranger flung into a hole. In the chilly morning, his face began to burn. He knew nothing of these people. They sewed gold and silver beads into the skin above their eyebrows. They smoked cheroots that smelled of savory and brine. The men were clean-shaven. The women tied their hair up in complex piles each morning and shook them free after sundown. Men and women mingled only at night. By day, they hardly seemed to speak. Where did they come from? What country? What clan? Eshet had told him to mind his own business. They'll let you know if they wish to, she said. And if not, you, of all people, should understand why someone might want to hide. The prayer ended. The crowd stood straight. Mektu lowered his arm. One of the elders offered him a pinch of dust and mimed the ritual gesture.
Oh, gods, sorry. Shit.
Mektu tried to rub the old man's forehead. Kandri turned away. Hopeless. Don't torture yourself. And then the lunatic attacked. He was just one of the camel men, a dusty face in the crowd. He struck Kandri in a flying tackle and knocked him right off his feet. They landed together, grappling, barely a yard from the pit. His attacker clawed at him, seeking his eyeballs, howling the prophet's name. His face awash with sweat and tears, missing teeth, black gouging fingernails. Then a knife. In Kandri's mind, something leaped. He caught the man's wrist as the blade descended and the knife bit the earth beside his chin. He raised his head and seized the man's whole ear in his jaws and hugged the man and rolled. The first snap was the blade breaking, the second his attacker's thumb. A spasm of agony, a howl. He bucked to his feet in one motion and kicked the man in the stomach and drew his machete from its sheath.
Kandri Hinjuman! Bellowed Mektu, triumphant. That's my brother! You do not fuck with this man!
No other attackers. 20 faces, staring, abashed. He could have brought the machete down for the kill, but did not need to. The man had fainted from the pain. But the letter. His hand flew to his chest. The calfskin pouch was still there. He could feel its rawhide stitching through his robe. He had not dared to part with it when they joined the caravan, and their slight possessions placed in saddlebags. He had sewn the pouch to his old army belt and wore it sidelong across his chest. Now it never left his person or his thoughts. How could it possibly exist? That letter more precious than his own life, than all their lives together. And how was he able to sleep at night, to walk or run or fight or breathe? Its few pages weighed no more than one of Eshet's flatbreads, but it was crushing him with its weight. Kandri turned his head and reeled. He stood just inches from the pit. He swayed, caught his toe on something. The black hole spun beneath him. Mektu's hand closed on his arm.
Bleeding?
Don't think so. He wanted to vomit, but it was only nerves. Cowardice, his mortal fear of being buried alive. The camel drivers, looking guilty, began to back away.
Thank you, Mech, Kandri whispered. Just a fucking minute,
shouted Mektu, freezing the camel drivers in their tracks. He pointed at the fallen man.
Who is this shit? What's the profit to him? You sand rats have your own religion, don't you? What do you need ours for? Are you trying to become Chilodos? If you are, you're cracked. I'm a Chilodo. It's not a clan you want to join.
The camel drivers inched backward, studying them with more than a little horror.
Not all believers are Chilodos, growled Kandri, steadying himself. And we're unbelievers anyway now, you fool. I know that, snapped Mektu. I forget. Now and then I forget. Answer my question, somebody! What are you staring at me for?
Stop clowning, said Kandri, and speak common if you want them to understand. Mektu obliged, unfortunately.
I'm not possessed, you know.
Oh, fuck. Kandri tried to throttle him, but Mektu held him at arm's length.
So what if I'm not like other men? That doesn't mean I have a thing in my head. Don't spread rumors. It's a nasty habit.
There were no fucking rumors. Kandri growled.
Ong's blood, we just met them.
Get me out of here.
But Mektu was no longer listening.
You worship the Prophet, eh? Some of you? Any of you? Listen, we know all about her. We killed for her. We carried her flag. And she's not what she claims. Do you hear me? She's no favorite of the gods. She's not invincible. She can't listen to your thoughts or punish you from a distance. That's nonsense. And anyway, she's a mess. All warts and wrinkles and bits of food in her teeth. And there's this smell sometimes. It's revolting. You'd think the woman dined on... Help!
The ground collapsed into the pit. First interlude. Typical. The wise brother undone by the idiot. The idiot saying what no one else dares to say. And the madman, the believer in he knows not what, flailing, falling, drawn to death like a salt lick. Knives, fists, fury, and talk. Always talk, unavoidable and inane. Arguments over gods who don't care, mates who won't return, offenses never to be settled in this world or the next. I'll come clean. I don't like human beings. And I'll ask you not to judge me unless you've done as I've done. Unless you've lived among them, worn their skin, dwelt in their sternums, felt the constant stabbing signals that race from brain to stomach to fingertips, listened to the gurgling advance of waste gases down the coiled tubes in their abdomens, learned their names, sipped their terrors, attempted that bludgeoning exchange they call communicating, glimpsed the lake of fire they call love. Go ahead, try one of them on. I'll bet you won't last a day. Mektu Hinjuman, now. A man so riven by self-doubt that he must bellow to strangers that his mind is his own. I'm not possessed. True enough, but is that something to brag about? Why should I wish to possess you? Given a choice of shirts, do you take the one with missing buttons, ragged cuffs, a loose patch dangling from one elbow? Don't answer, you just might. But we Yatras are fastidious creatures. We pull on the shirt least likely to come apart at the seams. I will not say that my choice of a host was perfect. I had but seconds, after all. This same fool Mektu put a dagger in the chest of the one I'd inhabited for a profitable year. The man may have survived. The blade grazed a lung but missed the artery. But how could I chance it? He was unconscious, bleeding out. And the cold was flooding me. Without a host, we Yatras are corks on the psychic seas. For a matter of seconds, perhaps a minute at most, we can fight the current, hold our position, paddle furiously in place. And then exhaustion claims us, and we drift. Months, years may pass before we wash into the harbor of another soul. If we are caught in a riptide, we may end up anywhere. Another world, a dead world, a world of blind invertebrates in caves. That will never be my fate. So I leaped. I considered the few humans at hand and chose one, slipping in through the eye, knowing before I reached the brain what an earth-shaking choice I had made. No, my host is not ideal. But neither is it, perish the thought, a Mektu Hinjuman. Shelter is mine again, but safety? That is far from assured. For what hope is there for this caravan? 131 scared, shuffling bipeds marching into a furnace. You'd be forgiven if you thought them all possessed. It is an inescapable fact that human bodies wither in deserts. They simply dry up and cease to function. Yet in they must go, chins lowered, backs bent, even the survivors of previous journeys throwing off little droplets of thought that taste of sugar water. Optimistic thoughts. This won't be so bad. The camels know better. Why not a planet of camels? Why not make them the talkers, the tool users, the lords of the earth? Made for the desert, those exquisite animals. And yet, when the dawn broke on the summit yesterday, and they beheld the endless wastes that lay ahead, did they lie to their human keepers, to themselves? No. The camels remembered. They erupted in long wails of misery at the sight. Of course, the humans know the truth as well, in their hearts. It wasn't a camel who named the desert Sumuridath Jal, the Ravenous Lands, or in the more gruesome parlance, the land that eats men, though in point of fact it eats everything and everyone. Splendid monster! Silent and beautiful it beckons, mouth wide as the world. Its fangs are gravel, its molars mountains, its smooth, inquisitive tongue the seas of sand that boil quietly over wells, villages, caravans, civilizations. Dig deep and you will find your ancestors entombed, shocked expressions on their skulls, still dreaming of conquests to come. It is your museum, your archive, your ossuary. It is your past as a species, and very possibly your future. In all fairness, you see, I do think of fairness, these camel drivers have no better alternative. None, that is, save the summary slaying of the brothers Hinjuman. Ahead lie the tomblands, famine's table, the Maristine floor. Yet behind them, mere hours, probably, is a greater danger than the desert itself, namely other humans. Death squadrons, worshippers of Her Radiance the Prophet, eager to crush and to crucify, to slash and hammer and gouge holes in the flesh of their human brethren, in a frenzy that always seems to me sexual, an ecstatic grappling with flesh, agonies created with the same abandon they reach for when creating life. What am I doing with these people? When did concern for them infect me? Why, by all the swarming stars, did I chain my fate to their own? The brothers and the maniac rode a torrent of sand and dust into the darkness, scraping along a wall they could not see, a wall that yielded like tissue paper to their hands. They choked, spun, tried to shield their faces. Along with the noise of the landslide, there was a second noise, a strange, sudden thunder approaching from every direction at once. Blackness, pain, a cry from the maniac as his body caught on some protrusion, stopping him cold. They fell away from his voice, away from the dwindling light. Then the shaft angled inward and they rolled to a stop. Filth poured down, burying them. The thunder increased. Kandri began to struggle. Mektu groaned at his side. They had not reached the floor of the pit, only a bottleneck through which Kandri's legs protruded, dangling free.
Kandri! Jashar, I'm sorry.
I'm all right.
Can you move? Fucking sand in my eyes. I'm not dead, though. What's that noise?
The thunder had become a vast, fluid roaring. It filled the shaft, filled the unseen warrens and galleries above them. And suddenly Kandri knew exactly what it was.
Mektu, he whispered. Don't move. Please, please, don't make a blessed sound.
The wasp?
Shut up!
It was the noise of 10 million wings. The dim light vanished. Somewhere above, the maniac was howling at them.
Abominations! Traitors to their Chiloto blood! Lord Jekka, rise and take their souls! Mine own for Her Radiance the Prophet! Mine own for the one true!
Nothing then but a scream, short and brutally snuffed, as though the man's throat had filled with ash. The brothers lay gripping each other, still as corpses in their cloaks of dust and sand. Kandri could not see the swarm descend, but he felt it. The air grew heavy with the weight of hovering bodies, pressing down like a plunger. 10 feet above them. Dust in his ears, eyes, nostrils.
Gods, let the dust hide us. Let it blot us out.
2 feet.
Could they sense his horror? The scream inside him, the violent thumping of his heart?
Inches. A draft teased the skin of his forehead, the air churned by their wings, his brother miraculously still, and the scream inside Kandri rising, fighting to escape. Always the darkness waiting, salivating, the starved earth spreading its jaws. The swarm rose. As one body, it geysered from the pit into the morning sky and was gone. Kandri twisted, retching. Mektu sneezed. And through the mouth of the pit, like a blade of amber, a single, perfect sunbeam probed the depths. 2. A Chat by the River. Martyr's Plateau, Ultima Othame, 79th day of winter, 3661.
You know I've always liked you.
She met his eye as she spoke. It was the simple truth, but her glance forgave him for not believing a word.
And dislike? He asked. What would that resemble?
Don't find out. They spoke in the same wry tones they used at court, and indeed his posture in the high-backed chair was fit for dinner with the lords of the realm. Spine straight, chin high, dark eyes level upon her. But they were a long way from court. When he blinked, the man's eyes sparkled in the morning sun, but it was only because tears had frozen at the tips of his lashes. He twitched at wrists and ankles, where the ropes were tightest. The chair itself was lashed upright upon a raft. From the shore, the woman in the white fur coat watched the motions of the prisoner's wrists. She had oval cheeks below bright, tapering eyes, olive-brown skin, black hair straight as a curtain, long braid tucked away inside her hood. A sober face, and thoughtful, the expression attained not at all by accident, a face befitting the youngest chancellor of Kasralys in 6 centuries, which is what she was. The thaw had come early. Across the wild river, chunks of ice like broken battlements were gliding downstream. But here by the banks among the cottony reeds, a delicate crystal skin had frozen anew overnight, and now blazed, perishing in the morning sun. The raft's nearest edge was beached in mud, but the rest was afloat, heaving and shifting, eager to be off.
"Shooting stars last night. Did you see them?" asked the prisoner. "Quite extraordinary, even portentous, if you believe in that sort of thing. I counted 21.
An odd number, thought the woman. Good luck for friendship. Who was it told me that? Somewhere downstream, a horse nickered, impatient. The man lifted gray eyes to the forest behind her. The woman waited in silence.
You expect me to say something, Lady Kosuda, said the man. But you must know I have nothing to say. If I did, those hellish dogs would have gotten it out of me by now.
They're wolves, Ersad, she said.
Wolves, then. What do I care? Demons at your beck and call is what they are.
You were not harmed, I trust?
I was brutalized, precisely as you intended. Scared out of my mind. This is nothing by comparison.
The woman, Kosuda Sarika Ser, glanced meaningfully downriver, where the spray of the great falls rose in a cloud.
Nothing? I do not work for the kingdom of Sholupur, he said, nor for any foreign power. Unlike you, I was born in Kasralys, and my parents before me. Like you, I'm a proud servant of the realm.
A cough racked his body. The blanket she had brought for him slipped from his knees.
Ersad Ramu, she said. How is it that you can waste your last minutes on a charade? I've always imagined that as death approached, I would lose all tolerance for lies, my own first and foremost. Will you kill me, then? Ramu asked. I would not put it past you, mind. I'm not one of those fools who consider you an exalted clerk.
She bowed her head, appreciative.
But neither would I doubt your readiness to stage all this. 2 days riding, my left ear dead of frostbite, wolves snapping at my scrotum, just to prove some sort of point.
No, said Kosuda. To save Kasralys from those who would destroy her from within.
a city unassailable by force. No such thing, said Ramu. A city that has shrugged off assaults for 30 centuries, she pressed on. Behind walls the gods would envy, and with the world's tallest cliff at its back. Such a city has but one thing to fear. Corruption. Daggers drawn against ourselves. You know this. You know that the Shoal and others dream that it shall one day come to pass. And hence you know that I cannot allow this plateau to become a corridor of whispers. If the Shoal must forever be trying to worm out our secrets, and I suppose they must, let them use the front door like other spies. The plateau is too much trouble for all concerned. She stepped nearer the water. But I am sorry about your ear. You're still good-looking, if you care to know. He smiled. Wasted on your kind. More's the pity. She placed her boot on the raft and pushed. It glided backward, revolving, shattering the reeds and their corsets of ice. The sun swept the man's dark face like a searchlight. The raft began to slide downstream. Kosudo walked beside him, hands in pockets. There's a name I keep hearing, she said. Thruko. Eyelash Thruko, said Ramu. Yes, I've heard of him. When and where? Palace chatter. Over a year ago, it was. Is he your cell commander? My... Ramu checked himself, visibly struggling for calm. He took a deep breath before he spoke again. Eyelash Thruko is a name, a nickname, I presume, for some oddball visitor from the north, or the west, I don't recall. Talk of him surfaced here and there about the city for a number of weeks, and then dried up. I never met him, nor learned his business with the realm. Why? For the highly suspect reason that I made no attempt to learn. Why? Because no one ever suggested that he mattered. Next question. Kosuda did not at first respond. She had bungled her question about Thruko, who mattered very much. Timing. Timing. Her old master had whispered the word, shouted it, threatened to brand it on her palm. All right, she said at last. Explain your visits to this place. 5 times in 2 years. Ramu rolled his eyes. What is there to explain? The Martyrs' Plateau is beautiful. I come here to recover from the noise and filth of Kasralys, and to hunt. That bow we took off you was laughable. It's what I could afford. You could afford a sablewood masterpiece by Rabanu himself, said Kosuda. The one you chose is ill-made and brittle from lack of use. It's a prop, my friend. You're no hunter. You collect wind chimes and books about the War of the Alchemists. The raft spun, a lazy leaf. His fine dark coat was torn at the shoulder. Since you will have a confession out of me, take this one, he said. Every woman in Kasralys who I fancy, really fancy, open my heart to, sooner or later gives me to know that she prefers the attentions of women. Can you explain that to me, Chancellor? Do you go about recruiting them to your side? It doesn't work that way, said Kosuda, smiling. And if it did, I couldn't help you. I have the opposite problem. He laughed aloud. Now I know you mean to kill me. You've never been so frank before. The raft shuddered, scraping over some hidden log or stone, and a surge of water bathed his feet. He gasped, trying helplessly to stamp them. I'd rather not, she said, almost in a whisper. Kill you, I mean. From his face, she knew he'd not caught a word. By my age, he declared through chattering teeth, I thought I'd be long done with courting. I wanted children, you know. I wanted to see them grow up to serve the city you think I've betrayed. It's still possible, said Kosuda. Tell me what the Shoal want to know. Gods of the Last March, he shouted. I do not serve the Shoal.
Not today, not yesterday, not ever in my 50 years. I've never even set foot in the Scarlet Kingdom. And you, Lady Kusuda, are a less gifted inspector than I supposed. Look up my ancestry in the Manual of Sages. You'll find no hidden shoal, Grandmother. No hidden anything.
Did they ask you to report on His Excellency's health? Asked Kusuda. Or perhaps the feuds in the Chamber of 40?
What feuds? No, hush, don't tell me. I care nothing for your politics, squabbles between generals, all that chaff in the wind. Just bring me ashore, will you please? My feet.
I'm also told, she interrupted, that beyond the desert, a crisis has seized the whole of the Chiloto clan. An assassination within the family of the Prophet, to be precise.
I give you my word as a gentleman, said Ramu, that is the dullest news I've heard in years.
Did the Shoal dispatch assassins to the Prophet's domain? Are the clans going to war?
Why don't you think a moment, Chancellor, he said. Even if I were a spy, how could I predict what the Chilotos, with their mystical drivel, would do next?
Orthodox revelation may be madness, said Kusuda, but it is not drivel. It is a faith, the creed of their liberator, however distasteful we may find it. There are even adherents in Kasralys.
It is a cult, he said, and a bloody-minded one at that. You really do have a problem if such gibberish is catching on.
You?
I mean we, of course. Don't play games.
It's your headache to remedy as the one who does the city's housekeeping. Because at the close of day, yes, you are a glorified clerk. And head butler, accountant, groundskeeper, rat catcher.
The lords of the realm must be pleased with you, he said.
Their talented pup, their little low-born terrier. So very efficient, cleaning up their messes, not leaving a trace.
You asked for honesty, m'lady.
I'm still waiting for it, said Kusuda. He shook his head, musing.
The Darsunuk, the time of madness. It's coming, if you listen to the servants, the sailors, the old grandfathers in the park. There's some gossip for you. Good Kasraji gossip, though I suppose you might hear it anywhere. But orthodox revelation? Why, it's hardly credible. There's scarcely a Chiloto to be found in the city.
A sly look came over him.
Ah, but there's one, isn't there? That young thing at the School of Medicine, the prodigy, who means to rid the world of plague.
Arikina Nawal, said Kusuda. She's a Chiloto, yes.
There you are, said Ramu. Ask her what has riled her prophet.
Dr. Nawal's no believer.
What if she is, though? You're not infallible. Perhaps she's the one you should have tied to this chair.
Perhaps you should answer my questions.
I remember, he said. She came to that summer banquet at the Sartaf's estate. In your coach, at your side. One of your projects, is she? And her beauty a mere coincidence? Give me something, fool, said Kusuda. Give me an option besides watching you drown.
The falls grew louder still. Kusuda took a deep breath, trying to calm her jangling nerves. The raft turned. The man revolved like a figure on a music box. His cough began again.
Forgive my teasing, he said. The truth is, I admire your taste. Persons like us, we only fall for the most difficult of conquests. Tortured artists, brilliant minds, those who cherish and suffer for ideals. You're a misfit in Kasralys. Why not love another misfit? Why not a Chiloto?
You are babbling, Ramu.
But there is gossip about your Arikina Nawal, he went on. Others have tried for her. Even a Sky Lord tried to sweep her off her feet. She would not so much as flirt. Dr. Nawal is spoken for, Chancellor.
She has a hidden lover in the city, or someone exceptional back home.
Speaking of homes, said Kusuda, who is to inherit yours? If the paperwork's awry, I'll gladly see to it. Just name the beneficiary.
He straightened. The Imperial Trust, he said, and my books to the Indigence Library. Put that in your report.
How noble. And your sister?
Ramu shook his head. We had a falling out, he said. Fortunately, she wants for nothing. You could let her know that I forgive her, however. I'd be grateful for that. I mean, if this isn't a bluff, if you're truly murdering a citizen, murdering me. Are you, incidentally?
She faced him, speaking as gently as she could. What was your assignment?
Help me, I'm begging you. What message were you taking to the shoal? Lady Kusuda, I am innocent.
She gave a defeated shrug. Aren't we all in our hearts? They walked together in companionable silence. A raven leaped from a branch in a shower of snow. The falls became a thunder she could feel through the frozen ground. And there, just ahead, her patient valet, shivering beside the coal-black stallion.
This is where I leave you, she said. There are two more bends before...
Well, you understand. I thought you might want to pray.
Ramu caught her eye once more as the raft revolved. His lips moved, toying with words he could not speak. Even now, it would be a simple matter to retrieve him, dry him off, whisk him home to the city, to wind chimes and tea. He shifted his gaze to the billowing spray, the 400-foot plunge into a cauldron of foam. The sunlight caught him again, and he was beautiful, one of the martyrs of the First Realm, a doomed saint in bronze. She turned to the valet and gestured with her chin. Let's be going, she said. The pines stood low and dense. In 20 yards, the river was gone from sight. Kusuda lifted a finger to her lips, and the valet saw her and nodded. They would take no chances yet. Another precious minute, leading the horse in silence through the trackless snow. They pressed through a holly thicket, up a steep embankment, along a wall of moss-gnawed stones that were, it was commonly thought, all that remained of Emperor Kavalismer's summer palace, and the grand fetes of 9 centuries before. Ahead, figures loomed through the trees. When they stepped into the clearing, everyone sprang to their tasks. The guards who had brought Ramu from the city were already mounted. First Marshal Lisrand, her chief aide, was conveying orders with grumbles and gestures, snowdrops glittering in his woolly gray mustache. He turned to look at her in that startling way of his, mild and piercing at once.
He knows something about the prophet, said Kusuda.
The Chiloto prophet? Lisrand's eyes widened. What does she have to do with Ramu's masters in Sholupur?
Ask his nephew, once we're back in the city.
I might, said Lisrand. Young Palachim is proving quite the asset. Still, you were right to leave him behind. No good could come of him seeing his uncle in such a state.
Is everyone in position? Asked Kusuda.
Everyone, said Lisrand. But the river is in flood, m'lady. Sunny days. This early thaw.
Kusuda felt a tightness in the back of her neck.
The shallows, not so shallow as we'd like, said the First Marshal. I measured a rise of 14 inches since. Piss of the great bitch of hell!
Lisrand shook his head.
Just melted snow.
Kusuda drew a deep breath, picturing the river, the double bend, the woods on the opposite shore.
14 inches.
Enough to drown the shallows ahead, speeding the raft toward the falls. How could she have failed to notice? What was happening to her? She blinked. Her people stood frozen, looking carefully at nothing.
Get on! She fairly snarled. What? Did you think we'd fold?
They sprinted to comply.
Kusuda stood in the center of it all, directing with her eyes. Now that their doubts were answered, her people were calm and efficient. She had drilled them for days. One brought her the telescope. Another pointed out the oak she was to climb. Then Lisrand cleared his throat. She turned. Before them stood a woman of her own height, her own color, her own thick braided hair. Sapu clan, like Kosuda herself, their ancestors brought to Urath at spear point and trapped here forever by the quarantine. Odds were that they were distant cousins, very distant, or Kosuda's research would have yielded the fact. She was 12 years younger than Kosuda, poised and smooth of skin. Her lips formed an enigmatic smile. Kosuda did not return it. "You can earn my smiles, girl." She tore off the woman's hood. "That braid is sloppy. Tie it again." Alarmed, the woman tugged at her hair. "Don't arch your spine in the saddle, either. That isn't like me, is it?"
"No, Chancellor. I'm sorry."
"And don't look back once you're moving. They will expect no second thoughts."
"I understand, Lady Kusuda."
"If you don't, we've made this journey in vain." They traded coats. Kusuda removed her own cap and placed it on the woman's head at the proper angle. Then she clapped her on the shoulder. "Mount up and be swift." The woman put her foot in the stirrup and vaulted onto the stallion. With a last glance at Kusuda, that smile again, damn her insolence. She shortened the reins and nudged the beast forward. The other riders fell in behind her. Kosuda watched her double with concern.
"Too young for the part, really,"
she said aloud. "I don't have an ass like that." The first marshal dropped his eyes, not saying a word.
"What of our forest friends?" asked Kosuda.
"Everyone's in place, m'lady. Everyone but us."
They walked to the oak. About its trunk, a thin rope was tied at shoulder level. Fiddle string tight, it vanished into the trees, angling back toward the river at a point upstream from where she had left Ursad Ramu. Lisrand plucked the rope with two fingers. Someone in the distance plucked back.
"Try not to fall on me, mistress," said Lisrand.
She smiled. This man had earned it 20 times over, and pulled herself lightly into the tree. The climb was sheer pleasure. No maddening choices, just this branch or that one, her good strong arms, ice kisses of melting snow. Memories flew at her like splintered glass. The lake house at Oprinu, the soaring willows, her sister crawling ahead of her along a limb, laughing, teasing, their secret place in the sun.
3 decades ago. How's that possible? Why do we sit festering in cities year upon year?
She eased out along a limb. The spot was perfect. Hidden by the surrounding pines, she could nonetheless see everything that mattered. The river's serpentine. The falls, grinding like the devil's own mill. The dark wood on the far shore. The raft, thumping along to its destruction, lofting its blunt human mast.
"Ramu, you great idiot! Why wouldn't you help me? Why wouldn't you turn?
The shoal would have killed you themselves soon enough. What would you have been to them after you spilled your secrets? What but a loose thread in need of trimming?" She glanced to her left. There was the party, charging uphill, feigning a return to Kasralys. The black and buckskin horses magnificent against the snow, and Kosuda's double at the center, square-shouldered, proud. Exposed to all the world, or at least to the eyes across the river. The eyes that wanted to see her city burn.
"Don't fail us, girl. Don't panic if the horse shies. Don't let them study your face."
She held her breath. There was another way this game could end. In grand betrayal, ambush, slaughter. A trap prepared so well, so early, that she and her people never dreamed they had walked into it, crawled into it, lain down at their ease on jaws of iron. If she could devote her life to such stratagems, why not her enemies? She shuddered. After so much preparation, it was unthinkable.
and therein always the danger.
The party crested the hill, the morning silent, the stallion steady as a god. Slowed by the broken hilltop, they picked out a path. Kosuda watched, oaths frozen on her tongue. Then they were descending. Then they were gone. Kosuda glanced down, gestured. Lisrand set his hand on the rope. On the river, Ramu's raft had wallowed into the shallows, or what had been the shallows. Despite the higher water, it slowed, dragging over submerged rocks. Ramu was writhing, another coughing fit, or perhaps sheer terror. Only some 90 feet remained before the falls. But it wasn't a cough, was it? The man was struggling with his ropes, making a last doomed effort to escape. This was better than she hoped for. The Ursad was quite visibly alive. 70 feet. Lisrand was gazing up at her from the base of the tree, making nervous motions with his hands. Ramu thrashed against the ropes with growing violence. Kosuda held the telescope at the ready but did not use it. She needed to take in the whole theater now, not the face of the fool at center stage. His suffering no longer mattered. 60 feet. Lisrand hissed her name. Kosuda raised her hand. Slowly, slowly. A boulder of ice struck the raft, jolting Ramu, splintering logs. Kosuda narrowed her eyes. Her hand still hovered in the air. Then, from the trees on the far shore, men came sprinting. 4 in all, shedding clothes and weapons and crying out to Ramu, "We're coming! Hold on, you bastard, you misbegotten dog!" Lisrand chuckled by the foot of the tree. He'd heard them too. The men plunged into the water. They flailed, sputtered, roared at the cold. But they reached the raft, and 3 of them slowed its drift while a 4th crawled aboard with a knife in his teeth. Shaking all over, he moved to Ramu and began to saw at his bindings. Kosuda dropped her hand. Lisrand jerked the rope. From their own side of the river, 5 wolves exploded from hiding. They flung themselves into the torrent, massive predators, leaping with the grace of seals. They swam in tight formation, with the huge pack leader the mountain hermits called Gray Flame at the lead, weaving swift and smooth through the rushing ice. Kosuda wished Lisrand could see them. The wolves were so beautiful it hurt. For 10 or 15 seconds, the men at the raft saw nothing. Then Ramu, still bound at the ankles, jabbed a finger across the water and screamed. Utter panic ensued. The men in the river let go of the raft and fled for land. The one aboard made to follow, but Ramu seized him in a death grip and fought him for the knife. When they separated, Ramu's hands were scarlet, but the blade was his and he used it, cutting the last of the ropes and leaping like a boy into the flood. His motions were stiff and awkward, and Gray Flame closed on him with ease. Ramu vanished below the surface. The wolf followed, and when they rose a moment later, Gray Flame had him by the nape of the neck. 3 of his would-be rescuers fell in similar fashion. The last made it to dry land and lunged for his sword, but even as his hand closed on the weapon, a wolf was on him. He fell under the huge black form and did not rise. "Ang's love, you perfect creatures! Where would I be without your help?" Flicker of motion. She swung the telescope, cursing already. A 5th man was sliding down from a tree. A lookout. Of course there was a lookout. He'd not seen through the deception, not given them away. But she had no one within a mile of his position. "He'll have a horse in the trees, same as we did. He'll get away. He'll talk." The man's boots touched the ground. A mile downriver, Gray Flame looked up and saw the man and hurled himself into the chase. Kosuda's breath caught in her throat. The man was gone already into the trees. Gray Flame flew like an arrow. But the distance was simply archers. "You should have lined the bank with archers, bungling fool." The other wolves hauled their quarry ashore. Ramu lay as if dead. The rest sat dazed in a circle. Kosuda signaled to Lisrand again, but her eyes went quickly back to the telescope. The forest's edge was still.
He never spoke to Ramu, she told herself, but he saw us all, this whole operation. They will know Kasralys is at work here, and the next time it will be us who are ambushed.
A full minute passed. On her side of the river, the rest of her team dragged the longboat into the water and started across. Well, it was time. Ramu was bleeding. If she delayed any longer, he could die. There came a cry of horror from the captured men. Gray Flame was padding out of the woods. From his jaws, a human head dangled by a flap of skin.
Those voices, said Lisrand as he rowed them across. Shoal accents, or I'm a cuttlefish. Your Ramu was lying through his teeth.
He was, said Kosuda, studying the shore through the telescope. But I don't want him to die for it. Can you row any faster? The First Marshal grunted, fighting the current. He tried to look over his shoulder, but could not twist far enough to see.
One of them's talking, crying, said Kosuda. Bleeding, too. Get me ashore.
The man in question lay on his back. The wolf's front feet were on his chest, and its jaws hovered inches from his throat. Heedless, the man wept and shouted and flapped a despairing hand. Kosuda hissed through her teeth. The hand was scarlet. Two fingers gone.
Knife work. He's the one who fought with Ramu.
You're less helpless than you pretend, Ersad. The man's voice rose to a delirious shriek. The wolf reared back, startled, then pounced and seized the man's neck in its jaws.
Pitfire!
Kosuda leaped into the water. The cold was so shocking she might have been in the jaws of some beast herself, but she struggled ashore, shouting at the wolf. The animal released the man and sat back, placid and unconcerned. Kosuda dropped to her knees before the captive. His throat was bruised but not punctured. The wolves knew the accord. None of these men were to be harmed unless they resisted. This one had held the captive as it might a naughty cub. So why that smear of blood beside his hand? Kosuda moved the captive's arm with care.
Ah, shit!
The knife had severed the veins in his wrist. It was a wonder he had made it to shore. She tied a tourniquet quick as thought, but many a thought arrives too late. For a moment, she considered plying him with questions, political questions, military questions, the ones that had brought her to this place. Then she loathed herself for the idea.
Stars.
The word came clear from his slowing lips, but it was a discharge more than a breath. She bent low, sheltering him from the wind.
The shooting stars, she said. You saw them too. Of course you did. You were here all night, like us.
The man's eyes swam in a hazy circle.
Do you want absolution? She asked. Is there a god you follow, or a saint? What name will bring you peace?
His mouth curved into a tortured grin. He could not speak, never would again, and so she tried to read his lips.
Ag, Ath, Thur. Agretu?
She tried, naming the shoal god of mercy. That smile again, derisive, almost mocking, and then the light left his eyes. Kosuda sat back, making room for death. She felt a rage that seemed to have no object, until she realized it was directed at herself. She did not kill gladly. Today she had not expected to kill at all. The dead man's smile faded as his muscles relaxed. She closed his eyes, whispered a quick intercession.
Let the quiet beyond worlds receive this traveler.
Then rose and surveyed the scene. The second skiff had landed. Her full team swarmed about the captives, who made no move to resist. Lisrand was kneeling, striking sparks with flint and steel, even as another agent assembled the firewood. The wolves had withdrawn into a huddle by the shore. The two surviving shoal rose to their knees, crossed their wrists behind their backs as ordered.
"What name will bring you peace?"
"Not Agretu." The guess had sparked only amusement in the dying man. She resisted the urge to nudge the corpse with her toe.
"Once more, you. Speak up."
"Ah. Ah. Tha. Ah. Ga. Thra." It would plague her like a half-remembered tune. She would wake in the night and toy with the syllables, see again the motions of those lips. Lips that were cooling now, that would dry and shrink in the cold. The lips of a corpse, not a man with dreams, plans, hobbies, a sense of humor, a place in the world. Perhaps a wife, perhaps a little boy or girl he'd fed with a spoon in the wee hours a month ago, before setting out on the long road south to meet a spy. One of her younger agents was approaching from the riverbank. She could see his smile from the corner of her eye, an eager smile above a short black beard.
"Victory, Chancellor," he said. 10 months of shadowing that swine of an Ursad, reading his letters, picking through his trash."
Kosuda nodded curtly, hands in fists.
"And now we have the proof," the young man continued. "Proof positive of his betrayal and of the true intentions of the shoal. I hope the Grand Ilim himself rewards you."
"For what?" she asked, cutting him off.
"We knew about Ramu already, and we've known for a century that the shoal wish us harm. Don't start the celebrations just yet. There is no victory until one of them speaks."
The young man's smile faded like a mirage. He lifted something, offering it for her inspection. It was the severed head. She made herself look. Disgust could wait. Sorrow could wait. This was what it meant to serve the Seventh Realm. The neck was a snarl of gore, but the face looked merely sleepy and distracted, like a boyish drunk.
"He was no one special, I think," she said. "Show Lisrand, just to be sure."
There. The oil-soaked firewood was aflame. She moved to it and warmed herself for a silent minute. Then she turned and walked upriver. The five wolves flowed around her, knowing what came next. Kosuda chose a flat stone and sat cross-legged. The great predators dropped in the snow in attitudes of indifference. All save Greyflame, who circled once about his pack and came to sit before Kosuda. Blue sapphire eyes. The smell of him came like a kick, wet fur and dander and rank human blood.
"I've never known just what you understand," said Kosuda. "But I thank you, wild brother. Our compact holds. All this land is yours, so long as I am Chancellor and His Serenity the Ilim rules the Seventh Realm of the Kasraj. As you serve me in my need, so I serve you. Only go to the hermit who dwells in Ormscleft. He will send word to me. I will come."
Greyflame's eyelids lowered once. His lips retracted, revealing 4-inch fangs. Then he stood and brought his muzzle, the jaws that had ripped flesh and shattered bones minutes before, close to her face. He sniffed with fierce attention.
"May the elk always be many," whispered Kosuda, "and your cubs grow fat."
Greyflame grazed her cheek with his fang, a thing he had never done. She sat terrified and amazed. Then he wheeled to face his pack. The other wolves rose, and all five loped with casual grace into the trees. Kosuda watched them vanish, then returned to her people. Taking Lisrand aside, she said,
"Drag the corpse into the forest, the head as well."
"Right you are, m'lady. We'll leave no scrap of them here. And Ramu's out of danger, long as we keep his would-be rescuers at bay. They blame him as much as us for how this ended."
"Did you check his mouth?"
"I'm not a trainee, am I?" growled Lisrand. "No poison pill, no hidden blades. In fact, he's got nothing but the clothes we provided."
"Good," said Kosuda.
I want no further surprises today.
Couldn't agree more.
Lisrand glanced upriver, and Kosuda felt a renewed stab of guilt. Greyflame had understood her error as well. The touch of that tooth had been no accident. He could have bitten her, scarred her, as the head wolf will do to one who strays from the established order, endangering the pack. And perhaps he should have, you blundering fool. If the scout had escaped to report the operation, Greyflame and his pack would never again have known peace. Like Kosuda's agents, they would have become targets of the shoal, and perhaps of other enemies of Kasralys. Perhaps of that most hidden enemy, that cipher.
Thruko.
She glanced at Ramu's shivering form.
By the beast in the pit, you will speak to me of Eyelash Thruko.
I didn't like the grin on that dying man, said Lisrand. A grin of hatred and a taunt. He knew something, or wanted you to think he did. What was it he said at the end?
I'm still trying to work it out, said Kosuda. I asked what name would bring him peace. He answered with that wicked look. And a word, a name, I think. Agretu, Agrator.
Not.
Hush, whispered Kosuda. No, not Eyelash Thruko. That man doesn't show himself to foot soldiers.
Or anyone else, said Lisrand. A poor guess, forgive me. I wish you'd make another. It's driving me rather mad. When her aide said nothing, she turned and studied his face.
You do have another guess, don't you?
Lisrand's eyes grew evasive.
Come, she said. Spit it out. It can't be as bad as your first.
It's mad, but... Agathar. She nearly laughed. Therul Agathar, Magnus General of Sholupur, the miracle worker who saved his country in the last war, routing the Vajeks to the west and Kasralys itself to the southeast, the military genius of the age. But
you're trying my patience now, said Kosuda. Agathar's old as the hills. He retired before I kissed my first girl.
As recently as that?
Shut up. You're whistling in the dark. We get reports on that old man. He visits his garden in a wheelchair. He...
M'lady? The prisoner's face swam up in memory, his lips deliberate and precise.
Agathar.
It was a closer match than any of her own guesses, and had been mouthed by a man who hated Kasralys enough to join this team, to wait in misery and mortal danger for the arrival of a spy. A man who had flung the name at her with a sneer of triumph and died in peace.
Therul Agathar.
Every military mind in Urath had once lost sleep about the man. Every soldier in Sholupur had breathed easier when he left the field. Could the old general have moved on to spycraft? Could he have faked his retirement? The better to escape her notice, the better to undermine a city no army could overcome? Could General Agathar be the force behind this shadow enemy she had chased in circles around the realm, this Eyelash Thruko? Or did Thruko even exist? 2 years, and she had never glimpsed the man. Was he only a diversion, a rumor, spoon-fed to credulous Kasrajis like herself? A shadow to keep her busy, keep her eyes averted, while the true enemy prepared to strike. General Agathar, Eyelash Thruko. Could they be one and the same?
It isn't possible, she said.
You ordered me to spit it out, said Lisrand. Kosuda shook herself.
My next orders, she said, are to bring the prisoners across the river and yourself down from the clouds.
Lisrand raised an eyebrow. It was as close as he ever came to telling her off. Ersad Ramu, bandaged and tied once more, was already seated in the boat. No saint now, only a traitor, purchased by their enemies, a canker on the body of the realm.
Lovely excursion, he said. We should make this a regular thing.
You'll want to forget you ever took that tone with me, said Kasuda.
Ramu flinched, as if she'd passed him a cup of something foul, something best not examined too closely. The remainder of his life.
2 deaths today, she said. Shoal boys, your comrades, here at your instigation.
One of the captives gave a violent start, straining against the guards that held him.
No comrade of mine, he snarled. Those men were my brothers, dog.
I'm truly sorry, said Ramu, gazing at the river.
Sorry, said the fugitive. You can go rot in hell. What are you worth, you old stinking turncoat, that we should kill ourselves to save you? What's the prize we're here to collect?
He spat in the snow.
The deep secrets of Kasralys. Horseshit, I say. The city's not been a threat to us since my great-grandfather's time, and the gods know we can't threaten her.
The gods know all, said Ramu. Soldiers in the field, rather less.
I know a fool's bleeding errand.
Kasuda bent and fussed with her boots, careful not to glance at Lysrand. There was something unnatural about this argument. Was it staged for their benefit? Rehearsed?
Kasralys is more than a city, said Ramu, turning to face the captive. It is a state and a malignancy. It is the last live coal of the Empire that beggared this continent and enslaved us all.
Fuck off! That's ancient history.
One argues for destroying us, the other calls him a fool, thought Kasuda. Definitely a performance. But who is performing? Who's sincere?
A single coal can light the fire afresh, said Ramu. If we leave it smoldering, we may awake one day to find Kasralys marching again over this continent, and ourselves under the heel of a second empire, more terrible, more final than the first. The coal must be snuffed, don't you see?
I see a madman talking rot.
Your friends died for the freedom of their countryfolk, said Ramu. They died for all the people of Urath.
They died for nothing, spat the captive, writhing. Your mission's shit. Kasralys is impregnable. Any child could tell you that. She stood there like the god's own fortress for 3,000 years.
Ramu glanced sidelong at Kasuda. There's a first time for everything, he said. 3. Brothers in the Dark. Well of Rifalundra, Basaru Gorge, 79th day of winter, continued.
So you're not.
What, possessed? I had to say that, Kandri. I had to calm those fuckers down.
Calm them down.
I had to say something. Those camel drivers, they're dullards. They'd murder me if they thought I was carrying a yatra.
So you're not. I know what you're thinking, Kandri. That I'm dangerous. Some animal you're stuck with forever.
Mektu, why are you avoiding the question? Am I a host? To a demonic fucking spirit, chewing me up from the inside like a worm.
You try admitting that. See if a girl ever smiles at you again.
I'm not a girl, Mek. But you talk about me with Eshet, don't you? And then you expect me to share my deepest secrets.
So you have a secret?
Does that mean... Who cares? Who cares if we die down here?
By the lone beam of sunlight, Kandri saw why they had not been crushed. The landslide was mostly an accretion of hive material, like airy plaster, which the wasps had glued to the stone walls across unfathomable years. Sticky, rancid, sweet. The brothers hung suspended in this mass, along with a well-churned mixture of sand, earth, cacti, snake skins, dead wasps, skeletons of birds and rats and lizards, broken crockery, pilgrims' sandals. It was surprisingly comfortable. But it was also sifting, hourglass-like, through the narrows beneath their feet. Kandri couldn't tell how wide the bottleneck was, but he guessed it would prove wide enough for them to be swept through with the next collapse. And at some point the swarm would return.
You're right, he said.
Let's get out of here.
But how, exactly? They had slid 60 feet or more into the earth. Where the hive material had shorn away, he saw the ancient stonework. Walls, pillars, landings. All intact, and every inch of it carved. Peacocks, flowers, children. Monsters with the bodies of spiders and the heads of snakes. But 6 or 8 feet above their heads, the carvings gave way to sheer walls.
A crack, said Kandri. That's what we need, just a toehold. If we can reach those carvings, we're free.
Mektu turned his head sharply.
Kandri, the letter! You haven't—
It's right here, said Kandri, feeling the calfskin pouch against his chest.
Harach, do you think I'd be talking about escape if I'd lost the letter?
I guess not.
I guess we'd stay, search all this, no matter—
You're damn right.
No matter what.
A plague had been savaging the lands beyond Uroth's shores for centuries, where it was said to be a greater killer than all wars, famines, and lesser diseases combined. The plague did not much worry Urathis, however, for the simple fact that most were immune. Such amazing luck did not endear them to the people of the outer world, who claimed that the plague lay dormant in the lungs of every single Urathi, and so enforced a quarantine on the whole of the continent. In the calfskin pouch, Kandri carried a few scribbled pages that would transform the world, a cure for the plague. The only mystery, an appalling mystery, was why its discoverer had wanted no one to learn the nature of that cure. No one anywhere, save the doctor in far-off Kasralys City to whom the letter was addressed.
What if it's not just a cure? Some other time, Kandri. What if it's a poison? A weapon?
Stop talking, said Mektu. You're sounding like me.
Use it one way and it frees the world from plague and us from quarantine, said Kandri.
Use it another and it kills us all.
Pitfire, said Mektu. Look at him.
The maniac dangled 50 feet overhead, shirt caught on some jagged beam or spike. Every bit of the corpse, even the mouth and eyelids, had swollen grotesquely. It seemed less the remains of a man than a weird doll made of sausage skin. 4 taut red strings descended from heels and fingertips. No, not string. That was draining blood.
What if the wasp attacked the caravan, Mech?
What if, growled Mektu.
Then they're dead, that's what. Uncle Chindelin, Eshet, Talupeke, and all those camel bastards. What were they thinking? Good luck in the desert, can you believe?
He broke off, eyes narrowing, then cried aloud.
Gods, we're saved! There's a staircase!
Kandri turned only his neck. What a fine, what a beautiful staircase! But it was a good 10 feet from them across the pit, and the lowest step was about at the level of their chins.
Just slide over, he said. Slowly, slowly. No!
Mektu gave a wild lurch. The whole mass of detritus sank by a foot.
What the hell are you doing? It's gone. Stop that. It's not gone. I told you, it's right here on my chest. Not the letter!
Mektu twisted in place, scooping armfuls of debris.
The blade! It's gone! Stop, fool, before you kill us! Kandri hissed. Forget your blade. I've lost mine, too. There are spares in the caravan. Not my machete, Kandri. The blade! The Mataglan!
No.
Well, yes! You shit, Mech! You absolute shit!
The Mataglan. The great golden knife, jewel-encrusted, ancient. Eshet had taken it from the body of Ojulon, the prophet's depraved and bloodthirsty son, minutes after Kandri had cut the man to pieces.
Why in 5 heavenly fucks do you have the Mataglan? Said Kandri. It belongs to Eshet, we agreed. Did she give it to you?
Yes, cried Mektu.
I mean, give? Of course, but not the way you or I might. Did she give you the Mataglan?
Give?
No.
You stole it.
And now you've lost it down this sewer pipe.
I only borrowed it, Kandri.
I had to.
You're the filthiest hog in the wallow, you know that?
She hates that knife, said Mektu.
She told me it frightens her, worries her night and day, and it does the same to me, you know. I can't sleep, not at all. I was even thinking that I ought to just... Oh, there it is.
The handle of the Mataglin protruded from the debris some 6 feet to Kandri's left. The enormous blue jewel in the pommel winked in the half-light. Blood from the maniac above was spattering the grip. For a moment, the brothers held still, gazing at the knife. Then they lunged for the blade. Which was sheer madness. How could it matter less who held the Mataglin, that priceless, useless thing? Neither wanted it, and in any case, their lives were inseparable. Yet somehow Kandri knew that he, not Mektu, had to reach it first. The same lunacy had seized his brother. Lurching, swimming in the debris, they made for the knife. Kandri felt the rubble falling, thinning around his feet. They shoved each other, clawed, but it was Kandri's hand that closed on the hilt. His brother cried out as if in pain, and in that moment the debris fell in a rush. Panic took them. Both brothers kicked and pulled for the staircase, but the refuse was pouring like rain through a sluice. Kandri flung the Mataglin, heard it strike the wall above the stairs. They felt the funnel-shaped wall against their fingers, slick and featureless. They scrabbled and swore, unable to help each other, choking on filth. Kandri found his grip as the last of the detritus vanished. He heaved himself, seal-like, onto the bottommost stair. He rolled. Mektu was sliding. His arm shot out and just managed to seize a flailing hand, and seconds later his brother was safe beside him, gasping. 3 steps above them, the Mataglin lay unscathed.
What happened? Why did we do that? Jashar, Kandri. I don't know. Why the hell did you take the knife from Eshet anyway? What were you planning to do with it? Nothing. It's like I told you, she hates the knife. She says it weighs her down.
Liar. She doesn't even carry the damn thing. She keeps it in her pack on the camel.
Why don't you let me take it, Kandri?
Because I'm not a fool, that's why.
Now get up. I'll give it back to her. I'll explain. I'll
Mektu.
Brother, you're never touching it again.
The climb to the surface was easy. Passing the body was not. Kandri looked with horror at the man who had tried to kill him. A balloon of pockmarked flesh, a froth of blood and chewed wasps filling the swollen mouth. How many of you are there? They stepped out into morning brilliance. The red earth was aglow. Dust hung in the air where the men and camels had rested, but there was no other sign of the caravan. Relief washed over Kandri. He had imagined bodies scattered like fallen fruit.
They must have been running for their lives, he said. Uncle and Eshet wouldn't have left us if they had any choice.
How are we going to find them? Said Mektu, squinting into the sun.
I see 5 trails leading out of here.
They were north of the pit, said Kandri. But they'd have turned east as soon as possible, he pointed.
We'll take that second trail, right over the ridgetop. It's steep, but much shorter.
How do you know it's shorter?
Eshet. Her people hunt in this country.
Mektu's cheek twitched.
You talk with her a lot.
Do I?
You're not falling for her, are you, Khan? Go to hell. You'd never do that to me, right? You know how I feel about her.
I only know what you tell me.
Mektu glared at him. The look might have been unnerving if not for the bits of wasp hive stuck in his hair like crusts of bread.
I found her first, Kandri, and then forgot all about it, about her.
That was different, said Mektu.
Can't argue with you there. Months ago, Eshet had been kidnapped by flesh traders and brought to Eternity Camp, the sprawling central base of the Prophet's army. The kidnappers sold her to a brothel, and one night Mektu bought her services for the price of a chicken leg, she told Kandri later. When they met again after the killing of Ojulan, Mektu had no idea who she was. Eshet's disgust with Mektu could hardly have run deeper. It was almost miraculous that she thought well of him now. Their escape from the West, the battles and blight fighting and murder and fear, had left much that came before indistinct, a landscape under fog. They had been one thing. They were becoming something else.
"Let's just go and find them," said Kandri.
Mektu did not move.
"Are you lovers?" he asked.
Kandri turned to face him again.
"Yes," he said. "We can't keep our hands off each other. We do it every chance we get."
A moment's pause. Then Mektu burst out laughing. He cuffed Kandri on the cheek playfully, or almost playfully.
"Glad you still have a dream life," he said.
They ran uphill. It was a shortcut, but now that they were taking it, the danger of their position was suddenly all too plain. Full sunlight. A barren ridge spread open like a scroll to anyone approaching from the west. Once they reached the hill's opposite side, they would be hidden again, but the summit looked far away. And the ridge behind them, that was not far enough. Kandri imagined the storm of arrows that would follow their discovery. The faint whines, the thunk and clatter of shafts among the rocks. The last sounds they would ever hear. They had slain the prophet's favorite son, one of the future kings of Uroth decreed by revelation. She had branded them with her curse, named them the twin abominations. No matter the cost or the distance, she would see them dead.
"Brother!"
Kandri whirled, unsheathing the mataglin, the only weapon left to him, but his brother was pointing far up the gorge. From a narrow side canyon, an animal came running. It was a goat, one of the caravans by its markings, with a few yards of rope trailing from its neck. Blind speed, reckless terror. The creature was running for its life. Moments later, a black shape flowed from the side canyon. Swift and dense, it raced along the gorge, barely a yard above the earth. The wasp. At last, Kandri understood the singular. The cloud of insects moved as one body, a shark gliding between reefs. It formed an oval at first, but as it neared the goat, it spread two arms like giant pincers. The goat careened from left to right, but the black arms surged ahead of it and began to close from either side. The goat panicked, skidding, bleeding. Then the body of the wasp passed over it, and silence fell. Kandri felt a sudden, explosive fury at the camel men. Never mind a lone maniac, seduced by some confused fascination with the prophet. What about the rest of them? He'd trusted these people, put himself in their hands. Had they really brought him to the pit for good luck, a blessing on the journey? Or had they meant to dispose of him? The swarm was hovering in place. As they watched, revolted, it changed shape once again and began to ooze across the valley floor. When it reached the rim of the pit, the whole mass poured into the black hole like molasses down a drain. The body of the goat was already starting to swell. They resumed the climb, scrambling hand over foot. The danger now was the spectacle they had created, or rather, who might have observed it. For 30 minutes they climbed in desperate haste. At last, drawing close to the summit, they found a protruding boulder to hide behind and catch their breath.
"Why do you keep looking back?" said Mektu sharply.
Kandri started.
"The pit," he said. "I saw something. You wouldn't believe. When Tarek deserted?"
Mektu seemed to have forgotten his question.
"They brought him back to Eternity Camp and gave him his old boots and sent him marching around the drill yard. Remember? Around and around, hands on his head, forbidden to stop on pain of death."
"That's enough, Mech.
12 times around, in boots with long nails driven up through the soles. Later they tried to strip him for the blackworm torture, but the boots wouldn't come off. It took 2 men, one to hold his leg, the other to stop it."
"And all he did was run," said Mektu. "Quit loving the prophet and run."
"The camel drivers," said Kandri, frantic to change the subject. "How did they talk you into visiting the pit?" "They didn't have to,"
said Mektu awkwardly. I saw them leading you that way and just followed like a dog.
Kandri closed his eyes. Mektu had followed him the same way into the army, into exile, into the hell holes of the earth. On good days, he saw the trait as loyalty. On bad days, he was sure that Mektu couldn't stand the thought of Kandri having anything. A slice of bread, an army jacket, a lover, a glance into a well that he himself was denied.
She's got to them, hasn't she? Said Mektu.
Kandri shook his head. That's the real question. How many believers in the caravan?
14, for starters, said Mektu. That mob who brought you to the pit.
Maybe not, though, said Kandri. That prayer they sang felt sincere. And if they all wanted me dead, why use the maniac? They could have cracked my skull with a stone and chucked me in that hole and told the others it was an accident.
Not after I showed up, said Mektu. No one would have believed we both just happened to stumble.
They got cold feet. And the crazy one, he couldn't stand it. He was all set to kill for Her Radiance, and we were denying him the chance. So he just attacked me, alone. That's where crazy comes in. But don't fool yourself. The rest of that mob felt the same. Remember their faces? They detest us.
They fear us, said Kandri. Because we're green and the desert's cruel and small mistakes can kill.
And at least a few, obviously, have heard a rumor that we're enemies of the Prophet. But that doesn't mean they're killers.
The caravan, Mektu declared, is rotten with converts. Maybe all of them are secret believers.
What absolute rubbish.
Mektu shook his head. Someone's selling it to them, whispering about orthodox revelation. And do you know who I think it is?
Just slow down, said Kandri.
We don't even know if that silent fucker at the back, that's who, with the earring and the staring eyes.
That one, the dour warrior, always stationed at the rear.
I hadn't noticed the earring, said Kandri.
But you're right, he does stare.
So you agree? He's their leader.
I don't agree. You should see your expression. You stare like a ghoul. And you'll make a mess of everything with your half-assed suspicions. For all we know, it ended with this poor idiot who attacked me, a lost soul who'd fallen for the Prophet.
Mektu glanced at him, alarmed. Was that a joke? He said. Fallen for the Prophet?
Kandri, did you just make a joke?
No, you're sick.
Never be funny, said Mektu.
Not you, it's just wrong. But listen, there's one thing we've learned for certain.
He waited. Kandri heaved a sigh.
Well, he said at last, however many they are, 5, 10, 50, they're willing to defy the caravan master.
Kandri looked up sharply, gave a reluctant nod.
And that, said Mektu, is the worst news of all, don't you think?
His name was Ifimar Jod. A large man of formal courtesy and iron rules. Like Eshet, he was some manner of Parthan, desert-born and raised. Unlike Eshet, his face was cold and unreadable. He was older than their uncle Chindalin, and his beard reached his ribs, but he had the vigor of a man in his 20s. He marched with his arms slightly raised before him, as though preparing to seize whatever or whomever he faced. Eshet had warned the brothers not to provoke him. In the ethos of the desert, to cross the caravan master was unforgivable. Survival meant absolute order. The caravan's fighting men and women answered only to Jod, and Jod had guaranteed the brothers' safety. Such, at least, were the formal arrangements. The reality was far less clear. There were, in fact, two fighting companies, and they loathed each other. The caravan had set out with 30 mercenaries, hulking hired swords, all men, nursing a bottomless resentment of whatever had condemned them to this expedition. The other 9 warriors had arrived with Kandri and his companions, an escort and a personal guard. The 9 were all volunteers, and yet the most disciplined soldiers Kandri had ever known. 5 men, 4 women.
a unit that fought not for money but honor, as their captain had informed Jod in the artless manner of someone stating his own height or weight.
"Honor is the marrow of the soul," Jod had replied. "But while you travel with us, both honor and oath must bind you to me. You will fight at my command, and exhibit perfect obedience in all other matters as well. Such are my terms. Swear to them or leave us now."
The confrontation had occurred in a wide, wind-scoured valley east of the Arig Hills. Kandri's party had caught up with the caravan just minutes before, after an 8-hour run from the high peak where they had spotted them, far off and getting farther. When they reached the camel train, at last they had stood apart, bent over and gasping, unsure of their welcome. At Jod's remark about perfect obedience, the 9 soldiers had glanced at one another. Their captain, a soft-spoken, lonely-eyed warrior named Utarif, cleared his throat and reminded Jod that they were already pledged to another master.
"And any pledge to our general is binding until death," he added, "as I believe you're aware."
Jod's fury had reached a nearly audible sizzle. For reasons no one had disclosed, he too answered to General Tabassa, infamous scoundrel and secret lord of the Lutaral.
"We can swear this much," said Utarif, "to obey you in all matters, large and small, save those in plain conflict with our general's orders."
To Kandri's surprise, Jod had accepted the compromise with no more than an irritable nod. He moved on to the rest of the newcomers, studying them like horses at auction. He did not appear to like what he saw. But his response to the brothers, last in line, was altogether different. Jod looked at them as though they were the confirmation of something glimpsed in a repulsive dream.
"You are the sons of the inventor, Lantor Hinjuman?"
Kandri was thunderstruck. "Yes, yes, we are. Do you know him, Master Ifimar?"
"I do."
A blinding elation filled Kandri's mind. Beside him, Mektu went rigid, eyes wide with hope.
"When did you last see him?" asked Kandri. "Is he even alive? Please, sir, it's been years. Tell us anything you—"
The master raised a hand for silence.
"One day," he said, closing his eyes. "An earlier start by one single day, and I should have been spared this doom. We would have been too far ahead. You would never have found our path. Between your fate and ours, a mountain should have risen, impassable as the mountain of the gods."
"Sorry to disappoint you," said Mektu.
Jod inclined his head. Apparently, he took the remark as sincere.
"When the gods choose to speak, their decisions are binding even for the deaf."
His eyes snapped open again.
"But let us consider where things stand for the brothers Hinjuman, and for that matter, their uncle, by all accounts a man distinguished in loyalty."
"He is that," Kandri agreed. But he was thinking,
by whose account? By our fathers?
"You are condemned," said Jod. "You killed the prophet's favorite son. You left a second son bleeding his life out on the ground. Her killers are close behind you, perhaps less than a day. You carry something priceless, some talisman of hope, but the prophet cares nothing for this. She wants revenge, and she will have it. She will never, ever give up the hunt. Therefore, you must disappear into the desert, or into her chambers of pain and oblivion. No third way exists. Have I forgotten anything?"
It was horrible, the way he named these facts. Kandri had long since learned to hold them at a distance in order to breathe and eat and cling to sanity.
"This thing we're carrying," he said, "it's not just priceless."
"Not just?"
"It's more important than riches," said Mektu.
"Name it, then."
Mektu glanced at him sharply. Kandri swallowed.
"We can't do that, Master Ifimar," he said.
Jod brought his fingertips together before his face as if he were praying, but it was nothing of the kind. He moved his feet slightly. His eyes were fixed on a point near Kandri's collarbone. And suddenly Kandri knew, as surely as he knew his own name, that in a matter of seconds both he and Mektu would be dead.
"Do something. Speak. It's not up to me," he blurted. "If I knew you, if I could be certain..."
"Certain of what, you wretched animal?"
"Master Ifimar, this thing is more important than our lives, and the truth is I don't know why it's a secret."
"Exactly," said Mektu. "What could be more stupid? We should tell him, tell everyone. We should share it, scream it, paint it on walls."
"Mektu," Kandri hissed.
His brother recoiled.
"But we can't," he said. "Of course we can't. Not a word."
"Master Ifimar, the one who trusted us with this object
was born a fool,
was stabbed in the chest before he could explain. But we know he believed that everything depended on secrecy, at least for now."
Jod studied him then. His fury had not abated, but alongside it something else appeared, a kind of burning fascination.
"You are honor-bound to this dead man?"
"We don't know that he's dead," said Kandri. "But yes, we are."
"And it was his will that you carry this nameless treasure to Kasralys?"
"Yes."
"And surely you were trained in Chiloto battle dance?"
"We were, master. We're excellent fighters, truth be told."
"And you will swear obedience to me in all things?"
Silence. Kandri's jaw tightened. Mektu hid his face in his arm. Ifimar Jod looked from brother to brother, narrowing his eyes. 3 years before, they had taken just such an oath at the feet of Her Radiance the Prophet. A day of glorious madness, mind and body singing with the drug of faith. When they and the other new recruits completed the oath, 1,000 soldiers pounced on them with feral howls, doused them with wine, cheered their recitations from the 5 atrocities, the book that explained the justice of the War of Revelation, paraded them through Eternity Camp on their shoulders. The joy of it, the clarity. Brothers forever to the end of time. A month later, he was fighting, killing, in a mist made greasy by fire. No cheers, only mindless roaring and high shrieks of pain. Thatched roofs burning, a village burning. A charge after the routed enemy into a black bog that engulfed him to his thighs, the dead around him sinking in the ooze. The arrow-slain man with the stump of an arm still burning. The child lost beneath the muck save for a chin, a cheek, a lifeless eye. And there was that one, of course, and that other one with, and the one he dreamed of every 5 or 6, and the one he would forever. The first horror was what he had seen and done and lived in that campaign. The second was that he had continued as a soldier of Revelation, a good Chiloto, a believer, for over 2 more years. Now his faith was gone and his promise broken, and he was glad of both. Nothing good could come of such promises, only enslavement or condemnation if one tried to escape. In dreams, he squirmed under the vulture eye of the prophet, heard her voice of torn iron, screaming for his death. Mektu suddenly dropped his arm.
"I swear obedience," he announced.
Kandri's nails bit into his palm. No way out. No honorable way.
"I swear as well," he lied.
Jod studied them as though reading a message inscribed in glyphs upon their faces. At last he turned to face the caravan.
"These men are in my keeping," he said. "You shall honor them and make them welcome, and teach them what you can of our ways. If any man shall harm them, it shall be as if you raised your hand against my person. Take no liberties. I will know."
The command could hardly have been clearer, but in the days that followed, Jod himself had shown no great inclination to welcome the newcomers. He confiscated their food and a faska of water from each. He ordered them not to smoke, although the camel drivers smoked both clay pipes and sweet-smelling cheroots. He had yet to invite them to an evening tea, a fact that scandalized Eshet. And on their first night with the caravan, after the tents were erected and a cold meal dispatched, the master had appeared once more before them and issued his most startling decree.
"You newcomers shall not lie with anyone. You are forbidden all favors of the flesh."
Not bothering to observe their reaction, he withdrew into the dark, a phantom judge. Mektu, somehow certain that the order was directed at him, took Eshet's hand and began to explain to everyone present that there were oaths and oaths, a realm of practical things and a realm of the heart. "And everyone knows that rules change when you cross borders. Customs change, languages change. Some clans have no word for snow."
"Every clan has a word for liar," said Chindelin. "You promised to obey him in all things."
"All things, exactly," said Mektu. "All things, but not this." Chindelin shook his head. Captain Utarif put on a philosophical smile. Eshet, who had sat stunned since Jod's pronouncement, pulled her hand from Mektu's grip and shot a blazing look at Kandri. Their eyes met for the briefest instant, but it was enough. Kandri knew they would ignore the command, no matter the danger. And so, of course, they had. But each night was a mortal risk. They tiptoed away in opposite directions, groped together around the edges of the camp, listening for sniggers or jeers. Once Eshet had arched up against his mouth, and a cry had escaped her, and both of them had turned to stone. "This will end badly," he thought, starting to kiss her again. He did not want to believe that Jod could condemn them for lovemaking, but a deeper part of him knew very well that he could. Jod's contempt for the brothers was unmistakable. He would prefer them in irons, in the depths of the prophet's torture vaults, in unmarked graves. So why not kill them and be done with it? Jod knew nothing of the letter of cure, that short secret message which, God's willing, a certain doctor in Kasralys might decode, freeing Uroth from the quarantine, redeeming the world. Jod did not know and might not care. He was merely indebted to their mutual friend, General Tabassa. His hand, for the moment, was forced. And he loathed the obligation, would relish any excuse to be free of it, of them. The brothers' lives and the fate of a letter so much more vital than their lives rested on an unknown debt to a single warlord, aging, lame, diminished in power, in a land that had vanished behind them. They gained the hill's bald summit and scurried across it, rabbits under the falcon's eye. The world was bright, motionless, petrified. Kandri could hear each footfall on the rocks. Before them stretched a vast, burnt-orange plain, wide open, flat as an iron pan. Mektu pointed, appalled.
"Is that where we're—"
"Yes, obviously." But Kandri shared his alarm. Due north, the land was mild. He even discerned a hint of green, as though new grass were sprouting here at winter's end. In the south, miles-long outcroppings of saw-toothed rocks erupted from the flats. But their path lay east, and he could see no shelter there, only countless miles of emptiness and pain. Bleak expanses of earth and gravel, meandering scars of dead rivers, clots of dead-looking brush. Round depressions that might have been sinkholes or empty lakes. One strange white basin that glittered like snow. And farthest of all, a tattered crust along the horizon, the next line of hills. To Kandri, they looked as distant as the moon.
"You heard Jod, didn't you?" said his brother. "There's an oasis beyond those hills, an oasis with 1,000 palms."
"I did hear him," said Kandri. "I heard him say that beyond those hills there's another plain and another range of hills and then an oasis with 1,000 palms."
"Then we'll die," said Mektu, cheerfully enough.
Kandri glanced over his shoulder. "If we stand here, it's certain," he said. The summit was blade narrow. In 2 minutes, they had crossed it and were descending, hidden from any eyes to the west. This side of the hill glowed yellow in the morning light. And there, climbing laboriously up to meet them, was Uncle Chindelin.
"You daft bastards," he said.
He leaned on his war axe, gasping. His beard, trimmed barely less than a week ago, was bleached white by the sun. He scowled at them, terrible, their own private god of wrath. And far below him, the caravan appeared. Kandri had never seen it like this, in full sun, emerging from around the hill like a strand of multicolored beads. The dark and light camels, burnt sugar and buttermilk. The cloud of biting flies nothing could disperse or discourage. The camel drivers in their robes of dilute indigo. The trim volunteer soldiers, the slouching mercenaries. And in front, as always, leaning into the march, the tall, urgent figure of Ifimar Jod.
"Is everyone alive?"
"Yes," said Chindelin.
"No thanks to you. We had to stampede the camels out of the canyon. It's a miracle there were no falls, no broken bones. And what about our hearts, eh? We saw that hellish swarm. Eshet is just destroyed, and Tal's not much better, although she'd hate for you to see it. We thought you were dead, that you'd pinched the devil's ass one too many times."
"What about Jod?" asked Kandri.
"He mentioned impaling the both of you on stakes."
Mektu waved his hands.
"But those camel drivers, the pit—" "Ah, so it's down to them now," growled the smith. "Tell me, did they pick you up and carry you?"
Reluctantly, the brothers shook their heads. Chindelin had a way of turning them back into boys. The smith gestured over his shoulder.
"There are riders out there, north by northeast, on horseback, not camels. Jod spotted them right away."
Kandri caught his breath. He squinted and thought he saw faint gray shapes near the horizon. Shapes vaguely in motion.
"Are they Rasanga?"
he asked. The word made the others twitch.
"Too far to say," said Chindelin. "I had a look through your telescope and could barely count heads. Jod himself pulled out a scope as long as my leg, but I don't think he could be certain either. Of course, he said nothing. Never does. But we know that there's a lot of them, and that they're between us and Eshet's village."
"Then she can't go," said Mektu instantly. "That's obvious. She'll have to carry on with us. There's no other—"
"Don't get excited," said his uncle. "Let's see what Jod has in mind."
"She can't leave," Mektu insisted. "As for us, we should wait right here. Wait and hide and watch those bastards. If we're lucky, they'll head off in the wrong direction and we'll never see them again."
"Look over your shoulder," said Chindelin.
The brothers turned. High over the hilltop, a large bird was circling. It was a raptor, bright yellow talons, wings of tarnished bronze.
"That's a steppe eagle," said Chindelin. "Rare these days. The Kasraji emperors bred them for hunting. Did I ever tell you when I learned my birds?"
"No, uncle," said Kandri.
"Never, that's when," snapped Chindelin. "But I sure as hell know a steppe eagle. Her Radiance the Prophet gave one to Jihalkra. She wanted her holy firstborn to start playing the part, future king of kings and all that."
"Oh," said Mektu.
"He hates to talk, Jihalkra," said the smith. "But one thing he would talk about was his eagle. How clever it was. How he could just think what he wanted, and the bird would fly off to hunt it down. Small prey it would kill and carry back in its claws. For larger game, Jihalkra would saddle up and follow."
Kandri's skin had gone cold. The eagle stopped its circling and headed west, its long wings rising and falling, gathering speed.
"Those riders to the north could be anyone," said Chindelin. "But the shits following behind us? They're damned well servants of our blessed, bloodthirsty mother of all Chilotos. And I'd bet my lungs and liver they know where we are. Wait and hide is out of the question."
"Don't tell Jod," said Mektu.
"He hates us already, uncle. If you mention the bird, he'll shut up."
Mektu hid his face in his elbow.
Not one day of peace on this journey. Not one, said Chindelin. Your father called me his best friend, but part of him must have hated me to name me your guardian. Better if he'd tied stones to my ankles and chucked me in a lake.
The brothers said nothing. How could they possibly disagree? Their uncle straightened, frowning at the sun. Then he lumbered forward, scowling, and wrapped his arms around them both.
4. A Summons. Cauldron Farm, Kingdom of Sholupur, 80th day of winter, 3661. The messenger did not like to wait. The old man watched him through the iron fence and a skein of flowering vines. He was arguing with the chamberlain, sweating in his tasseled, tight-buttoned uniform, brandishing a scroll case of lacquered wood. 30, probably. At least they'd stopped sending babes. But the chamberlain had 20 years on him, and the old man another 20 beyond that. Let him wait. The old man's children were hungry. They were lizards, his children. Red iguanas, chameleons, lion geckos longer than his forearm. The old man's gardens bordered the rainforest that swept up the mountain and down the other side, a last fragment of the jungles that had once blanketed central Sholupur. He had let the jungle reclaim 3/4 of the land he owned, including 2 acres of the mansion grounds, so fond of these reptiles he had become. Every morning he walked to this wild corner with offerings of dates and melon and sweetened gruel. Down from the trees they clacked and clattered, a voiceless battalion, following his movements with eyes that rolled like the marbles he had flicked across these stones as a boy, marbles that still surfaced now and then when he wielded a spade. He lifted the tray from the breakfast table. The messenger noticed his movement but turned away, disinterested. The old man smiled, mistaken for his own gardener. There was something to be said for turning 70. Other peeping eyes, though, had surely been more discerning. Someone has seen me without the wheelchair, perhaps riding, perhaps rambling in the mountains afoot. A good ruse while it lasted. How will I keep them away now?
I am not to leave unanswered, he was shouting, the fool. Those are my explicit instructions from a higher master than your own.
The chamberlain straightened his spine.
There are few who meet that description between the desert and the sea.
There is one, said the messenger.
The old man sighed. A phoenix lizard brushed his ankle, red scales raised like feathers about its neck. Others were approaching, belly sliding through brush and leaves. He tossed the food widely, dispersing them. Beautiful as they were, they would fight to the death over a scrap of melon rind. A matter of instinct, nothing more.
My good fellow, said the chamberlain, if you would simply allow me.
No and no again, cried the messenger. I am to surrender this missive in one manner only, and that is to the hand of Therol Agathar.
In that case, I can offer you no satisfaction but to wait in the foyer, said the chamberlain. His Excellency is not yet dressed.
When is he likely to dress? Now see here, you brazen—
Never mind, called the old man, startling them both. I'm as dressed as I plan to be. Show him in.
His accomplice, the wheelchair, stood proud beneath the almond tree, unaware that it would never fool anyone again. The general brushed off the leaves and sat, and the real gardener brought a second chair and set it facing his own. Moments later, the messenger appeared, striding well ahead of the chamberlain, gripping the scroll case like a relay baton. The man flung himself down on one knee, bowed his head so low he might have been inspecting his genitals for lice.
River dragon!
That's not me, said the old man sharply. That man retired 10 years ago. My name is Therol Agathar.
My apologies, Magnus General. I was told. My master quite insisted.
Have a seat,
There's tea on the way. He pried the scroll case from the man's death grip, gestured with it at the chair. The messenger continued to kneel, raising his head just high enough to see what the general might be doing with the scroll. Agathar waited. The messenger opened his mouth, shut his mouth, blinked, swayed, grimaced, swallowed. A fly crawled across his forehead. He rose and took the chair.
"Welcome to Cauldron Farm," said Agathar. "You're our first guest this year."
"Alas, sir, my tenure as guest must be brief. Not brief, less than that. Momentary."
"I'll provide a fresh horse for your return," said Agathar.
"Very kind, Your Excellency. The message..."
"Have the rains begun in Nebusul?"
"The rains?"
The messenger looked ready to explode.
"Magnus, General, the letter I bring you is from the hand of our beloved king."
"That's plain enough from the seal. How is he, by the way? I've not clapped eyes on him since his divorce. His third divorce, from that cousin who paints. Now and then he threatens to visit, but I'm not holding my breath."
The messenger froze.
"King Grappa here is a gift to all the people of Sholupur," he said.
"This isn't a test, you know. We're just talking."
"He inspires us as much with his vigor as with his mind. He is our voice, our defender. Indeed, he is the nation, as many say. The Scarlet Kingdom in human form."
"Does he still hold public executions?"
The messenger's jaw fell open.
"No," said Agathar. "Well, perhaps it's for the best. In his grandfather's day, when executions were a private entertainment, they used a pool on the castle grounds built for the purpose. Round, sheer-sided, deep, 20 feet deep, and filled to within 5 feet of the rim. Placing that rim just out of reach, you understand, for a swimmer below. Have you heard this tale before?"
"Your Excellency, I..."
"The prisoner would be stripped, branded with a symbol corresponding to the crime, murder, theft, kidnapping, and forced down a ladder into the pool, after which the ladder was withdrawn. Chairs were set around the pool, and they'd serve tea and cloudberry pudding. Not to us children, of course. That part of the grounds was off limits to us. Still, the adults must have known we spied on them. I think my father secretly approved."
"General Agathar!"
"They floated a good inch of oil atop the water, you see. Ballistics oil, fast-burning stuff. And upon the oil floated a dozen or more wooden saucers with lighted candles. The sport of it was to guess how long the prisoner could tread water without disturbing the candles. Once he started thrashing, it was hopeless, of course. You can imagine the waves in that pool."
"Magnus, General! The king commands me to seek your immediate reply and to depart the very moment it is written."
"Yes," said Agathar. "But if I delay out of obstinacy and you gain the few minutes rest any man should be afforded, that can't be held against you, can it? Here's your refreshment."
"River, that is, General, I..."
"Just eat, man, and drink your tea slowly. We serve it blistering here."
He read the letter twice, then a third time. He cracked his knuckles, stalling. The messenger's eyes betrayed a hint of vindication. For several minutes, no one spoke but the querulous raven in the wood beyond his estate.
"Kraka,"
it said, which happened to be a word in the Vajek tongue. Kraka. How the ravens had screamed it on the banks of the Brofin, one silent morning after carnage. Kraka, stab wound, the only word it appeared to require. The letter was full of chattering nonsense. "All of us recall with delight how you, several years since we had the pleasure of, my niece has developed quite a fondness for." But the blot of ink by the salutation announced a coded letter. The king had embedded certain telltale words from the old list in his day book, surely. The man could hold nothing in his head, which conveyed an altogether different meaning. An emergency summons.
a threat of some sort to the very life of the kingdom of Sholupur, and no time whatsoever to waste. Agathar lowered the parchment, ashamed of himself, and frightened. Listen to that, will you? Old man's heart in an old man's chest. Thump, thump, flutter bump. Captive bird in a crate. The messenger must have decided that he was a fool, chattering on about old horrors with new ones close enough to touch.
But what is it? He demanded of the messenger. War? Rebellion? Some new disease? Don't hide behind protocol. If you know, I command you to speak.
Magnus General, all I know I have conveyed already.
Agathar let out a sharp sigh and rubbed his forehead.
Of course you have. I alone am to blame. Forgive me.
The messenger dropped his gaze, embarrassed.
Stab wound, said the raven, delighted. Stab wound, stab wound.
As though it had invented such wounds and were celebrating. He sprang to his feet, dry gristle of his knees protesting, and shouted for the chamberlain.
Pen and paper, and my riding clothes from the parlor. Bring Hesper in from the east field and get him saddled. Provisions, standard road kit. Departure in 20.
He pointed at the gaping messenger, who had not yet risen himself.
Pack this man a meal for his journey, and make it better than my own, as he's the finer servant of Sholupur.
5. Lovers and Ghosts. Hasthu Plain, Outer Basin, Great Desert of Uroth, 79th day of winter, continued. The brothers' return left the camel drivers speechless. No one stopped walking, of course. The caravan's forward motion had to be sustained, like some great stone wall to which they'd all put their shoulders. But their astonishment was plain. They watched the brothers approach in silent awe, walking songs dead on their lips. It was an older woman who broke the silence at last, almost shrieking the obvious.
Tufani! Alive! Alive! Both of them! Not dead, but alive!
The nearest drivers hushed her, walled her off behind their bodies. We're always disappointing someone, Kandri thought.
Jod's changed direction, said Chindalin, squinting at the hills. He's veering south. Those riders must have spooked him.
We should apologize to Jod, said Kandri.
You should do no such thing, hissed Chindalin. Give him time to cool down. And for Aang's sake, don't cause another scene. Just shut your mouths and walk.
His advice proved impossible to take, for now the camel drivers had recovered from their shock. Men and women alike rushed forward to press the brothers' hands, making that fluid half-bow Kandri had come to recognize as standard courtesy. He bowed too, with less elegance. Mektu's efforts were like the bobbing of a crow.
The well gives you up,
said Kandri's friend with the cataract-clouded eye, almost tearful.
You are blessed, Mr. Kandri, and your brother alike.
He looked at his fellow drivers.
Kibin Damra, are they not blessed?
None dissented. They were blessed. Kandri thanked them, wondering which, if any, had murder in their hearts. The more the drivers discussed their survival, the more animated they became. Heaven has a task for you, they declared, a special purpose, and we stand in your light, in the warmth of your fire. Then they spat out the name of the dead man and cursed his attempt on Kandri's life. Such a man was their brother no longer.
He's not anything any longer, said Mektu. He's not even watertight. Some reward for faith in her radiance, eh? Hanging there in the dark like a bag of fermented curd? Maybe the rest of you will listen to me now. She's not worth it. Loving the prophet will bring you nothing but...
He broke off. A striking figure had stepped from the crowd. She was a girl in her teens, muscled like a wrestler, armed head to toe. Her eyes, haunted as always, flickered from Kandri to Mektu and back again.
You stupid fuckers, she said. How many lives do you have?
Love you too, said Kandri. The girl cackled, Her arms rose, as though she would embrace them, as Chindelin had done. But then her face clenched in a spasm, and she glanced away. She was a soldier, one of General Tabasa's 9. The brothers and their company had found her in a wasteland, lone survivor of a decimated squadron. Lost, drugged, damaged. Her name was Talupeke.
"I'm sorry we worried you," said Kandri.
"Shut up. Here's a riddle."
Talupeke looked at them sidelong.
"These drivers, what's their new favorite word?"
"That's no riddle. That's just a question," said Mektu. "Give me a hint."
"You can't see it, but you think about it all the time."
"A woman's no." "A sugar pudding. A stuffed chicken. A rump roast. A leg of lamb."
"One word," said Talupeke. "Wasp." "No, fool. It's something no one can see."
"Wind. Love. Music." Chindelin growled something in his ear, and Mektu's face fell.
"Oh," he said. "I'm sorry."
The smith turned to Kandri.
"Yatra," he murmured. "They believe in the creatures. Entirely."
"And now they've decided he must be carrying one," said Talupeke. "So have I, for that matter."
"Don't joke about such things," said Chindelin.
"Who the fuck says I'm joking?"
Mektu shook his head.
"They have no reason to think that. Why would they?"
"Why?"
Chindelin counted off on his fingers.
"You babble about possession. The pit swallows you and spits you out unharmed. The swarm passes you by. So yes, the idea has taken hold that you're carrying a yatra, that you're protected by it. And Kandri as well, I suppose, as long as he's at your side."
"In short," said Mektu, "they're blithering fools." "That's not what Eshet says,"
said Talupeke.
"She told me to imitate them after she's gone. They may not be Parthans, but they've crossed the desert before."
At the mention of Eshet, Kandri felt a stab of longing. "Where is she, anyway?" he asked, trying not to betray his urgency.
"Up ahead with Jod," said Talupeke. "She and my grandmother are trying to explain why he shouldn't have you strangled."
She laughed again.
"You'll keep your distance if you know what's good for you. That man's face could make a bull run for the hills."
Mektu, who had never known what was good for him, started forward at once. Kandri reached for his arm, but another stopped Mektu first. It was the surgeon, a small, plump man with graying sideburns. He stepped into Mektu's path, frowning over his eyeglasses.
"The daredevils," he said with some disdain. "You look a fright, both of you. Shall I start with your heads?"
The brothers glanced at each other. Back home, they had worked in Arikina's clinic for the poor. The army had taken their medical knowledge somewhat further. Both experiences had left Kandri suspicious of rural quacks.
"Don't trouble yourself," he said.
"Trouble? They say you fell 90 feet.
"We got lucky, doctor. We're all right." "I'll be the judge of that."
He turned to Mektu.
"You had a prior wound as well, I understand. Recent infection? Nearly killed you?"
Mektu shot an uneasy glance at Kandri. One hand rose instinctively to his left side, just above the hip. The little man knocked Mektu's hand away and tugged up his shirt. There was the scar from the Rasanga arrow, closed and healed, though still slightly discolored. The surgeon's eyes grew wide.
"I'm floored, young man. That's Zavacindran work, or I'm a magpie."
He snapped his fingers.
"You have the luck of the gods. The outworlders almost never treat common battlefield wounds. They're not interesting enough."
"Don't feel lucky," said Mektu, like a bashful schoolboy.
The little man snapped his fingers.
"Black Hat Tabasa! The general snuck you into the clinic at Mab Makutin, didn't he?"
"He helped," Kandri admitted.
"Well, well, the old fox. Now bend over and show me your pupils."
"Next time, doctor," said Kandri. "We're all right, I promise."
The surgeon's face hardened, as though he were not used to being refused.
"With that attitude," he said,
I doubt you'll live to see many next times.
He stepped away, still muttering to himself. But some of the camel drivers had understood the exchange, and the murmurs of awe redoubled.
They are not even wounded. The madman, the fall, the wasp itself. None of it has touched them.
Neither did their whispers, at least in Mektu's case. His fears and his glances were directed to the north.
What do you think? He asked no one in particular. Are the horsemen from her?
Oh, I'd put money on it, said Talopeke.
Sons of bitches, said Mektu. They're going to see us.
Not without a telescope.
Of course they'll have telescopes, girl, said Mektu. We should turn due south. Jod's not thinking. Pitfire, it's almost as if he wants to be seen.
And maybe he does.
We're just an obligation, aren't we? One he'd be damned glad.
Chindelin reached out and squeezed the back of his neck, not at all gently.
You will desist from such talk, he said. You're deep enough in the latrine as it is.
But, uncle,
go check on your camel, boy.
You'll look less idle that way.
Mektu obeyed, or seemed to. When he reached his cargo camel, he merely patted the beast and kept walking.
He's going to pester Eshet right in front of Ifimar Jod, said Chindelin. Damn the bastard. If there's a sore toe anywhere in the schoolyard, that fool has to find it and stomp.
Kandri nodded, but for once he envied his brother's recklessness. His own need to be close to Eshet was becoming unbearable. They had so little time left. And what would his brother do when she departed? Collapse? Go mad? Or simply forget her, as he'd done before? Look at his loping figure. Whiplash strong, fearless in battle, dangerous to himself. A gifted man, an idiot. A cruel and spiteful ass. A man who'd give his life for Kandri or Uncle or any of them. Somehow it all added up to Mek.
He is the one, you know, said Talopeke. The one with the yatra inside.
Hush, hissed Chindelin. That's nonsense talk, and dangerous.
I saw him, said Talopeke. On the mountain, on Alibat Sang. Grandmother saw him too, and we heard what came out of his mouth.
That was a parlor trick, said Chindelin. You throw knives, he throws voices. And it worked, didn't it? Our enemies thought they were facing a man possessed, and it rattled them. Made them hesitate until you lot arrived. If he'd kept quiet, we'd be dead.
You're telling me it was an act?
What else? Said Chindelin.
Talopeke turned him a scathing look. She quickened her pace, leaving the two of them behind.
Never lie to me, old man, she called over her shoulder.
Kandri and his uncle exchanged a glance. She was right, of course. Mektu's eruption on Alibat Sang was much more than a parlor trick.
But what was it, then?
Madness? Possession? Some other kind of spell? Mektu, for his part, dodged every question. His trick had bought them several precious minutes, enough time for Talopeke and her fellow soldiers to arrive. He had saved them. What more did they want?
Answers, thought Kandri. Some straight answers. Would that kill you?
Muffled shouts from the front of the caravan. Three mercenaries were dragging his brother back along the camel train. Chindelin sighed.
Eshet's influence with Jod must have its limits.
Mektu was writhing, a weasel in a snare. The mercenaries swore at him. At last, judging the distance from the master sufficient, they flung him face first to the ground. Late morning. The plain blazed and shimmered. Already the heat was like solid barrier, a wall they pushed before them with their chests and faces. But much worse was the roaring in Kandri's mind.
Look back. I will not look back. Look north, then.
What's the point? What good could it possibly do?
You know they're coming. You know how close those killers are.
It lied, that voice of fear. All he knew for certain was what he saw out ahead. The next hills, impossibly distant, and farther yet thanks to Jod's swerve to the south. Kandri looked for Eshet in vain. She was among the women, where he would not be welcome until sundown.
Look back.
Why should I? Tell me that, or shut up.
Because you like to look at me.
Kandri almost laughed aloud. He was conversing with a ghost. He knew that now. And whether it was real or fancy or sudden madness, it was good to know that the dead could be as wrong, as plain stump stupid, as the living. The dead had appeared to him before. In the wastes of the Skralem, he had seen whole fleets of drowned fisherfolk and war galleys, plying a sea drained dry centuries before. And just yesterday, he had watched flies of ghost women making their way up the same mountain trail the caravan was descending. Women in sarongs and canutes, bearing casks, jugs, faskas, the water no less heavy for being ghost water. Women whose eyes searched the cold hills for home. Desert women, strong and severe. Women with Eshet's cheekbones. No one else had seen them. No one but the hairless dogs, who had growled and trembled. Kandri wondered if they saw what he did. The women glowing like marsh candles in the darkness, flickering out as they neared the caravan, springing to life again once they passed. 3 months ago, that vision would have flooded him with horror. But since their flight from the army, his sense of the nature of the world had been knocked off the table, shattered like the dull bit of village crockery it was against the strange stone floor of Urath. Ghosts? All right. Tip your hat and keep moving. Weirder things had assaulted him. Darker burdens, the prophet's curse, the hatred of his own people, had swamped his life. But this new ghost was not like the women or the fisher folk before them. For starters, it appeared by daylight, though it clearly preferred the darkness. It was also pursuing them. Sometimes it wandered or lost the way. Sometimes it raised an arm and braced itself against a wind the living could not feel. Under the noon sun, it became so transparent that it almost disappeared. But as dusk approached, it solidified anew, half a mile behind them, matching their pace. The ghost was different in one other respect. Kandri had seen its birth, or at least its birth into death. It had occurred as he and Mektu stepped away from the pit. Feeling an obscure sorrow for the man who tried to kill him, Kandri had glanced a last time at the bloated corpse and seen the ghost peel away from it like a rind. All in one fluid motion, save for its left hand, which remained snagged in the corpse's own. The ghost tugged at it, vexed. When at last the hand popped free, the ghost winced and cradled its thumb, the thumb Kandri had broken against the earth. The ghost was otherwise pristine. The numberless stings of the wasp were nowhere evident, but the thumb, quite obviously, still gave it pain.
Look back, urged the believer. Look back. Come back to me.
There were no limits to the prophet's hunger for revenge. Not even her dead servants were exempt from its call. A yip. Kandri jumped and saw one of the caravan's hairless dogs trotting at his side. It was a lovely creature, gazelle thin, its fox-like ears too large for its head. It looked earnestly at Kandri and yipped again.
You're a charmer, said Kandri, but you can't have my food.
Tana dog is not begging, Chiloto.
He raised his glance. Ulrin, Jod's second in command, was watching him with a sneer. He was a thin man with a rough, bulbous head, like a squash to which a narrow face had been grafted. Although he looked rather starved and sickly, he possessed a freakish energy that never seemed to wane. He spent much of the day trotting from consultations with the master down the length of the train, repeating Jod's orders a dozen times until he reached the dour submaster who brought up the rear.
"Don't whine, milksops," he told the brothers upon their arrival. I won't take kindly to whining. Remember that for every mile you walk, I walk three.
It soon became clear that "don't whine, milksops" was Ulrin's message for all persons and circumstances.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.